Now, you grew up living in housing commission, but you eventually moved with your mother to live with your grandparents. Why was that?
We had some things go down. You know, no disrespect to housing commission, because it gave us a roof over our head when we may have not had one, you know. So all props to anyone living and doing their thing. You know, I've got some fond memories. But, yeah, there were some fellas that obviously decided to take advantage of a single woman and mum, and stole my mum's cat, dumped it. We'd get on the roof drunk, meowing, you know, got out of there to the next spot. Things went down again. You know, I look back now and realise I was obviously carrying trauma, because I would start having nightmares and have mum up, walking up and down the house with the crowbar, you know, going, "Mum, they're going to come and get you. Mum, they're going to get you." So it was just right that we went out and kicked it with Nan and Pop for a while until I was about 15, and then we moved out on our own. But, I mean, that was some incredible formative years, you know, being able to live with my grandparents, what a blessing.
Mm. Now, during your early teenage years, your mother started to encourage you to embrace your Gamilaraay culture and your identity. Why was it so important to your mother that you learnt more about your culture?
I think that she could see maybe my personality, that I was either going to take path A or B. And I think she could see straight away that going down a path of, you know, embracing my identity and culture would do everything it needed to do for me. You know, it would be medicine, it would guide me, and it would connect me to where I needed to be connected, and that's to my ancestors, you know, ones that I may never have got to meet or don't know what happened to them, but I feel that now in my spirit. And I remember the first time that I ever witnessed Krobbery style dance or movement, and I remember what that did to me, and I carry that feeling today. You know, it lit a fire inside of me that from that point on I could just never escape wherever I went.
And has culture become an important part of your life?
100%. The culture is at the absolute core of my life. You know, culture is not like a hobby. It's who I am. You know, I carry it every day.
Traditional dance is something that seemed to resonate with you. Why was this?
I think it's the strength. It's the power in it. It's the spirit in it. It's the stories that when you sit and yarn with, you know, the old fellas, there's always something that comes out of those yarns that just pumps you up spiritually. You feel so charged up. And I remember being this young fella doing the bunda and dancing and just feeling unstoppable, you know, and I just wanted more and more and more. And then you start to understand the stories, understand the connection, understand what you're tied to, and it just continues to stand you up and form this bond with the world we can't see.
Now, in 2010, you were still in high school, but you remarkably found yourself at the Vatican helping to lead the procession for the canonisation for Australia's first Saint Mary MacKillop. How did you manage to become part of such a huge moment of Australian and Catholic history?
Yeah, so I wish I was that young. I actually finished school in 07, but in 2010, I got hit up. One of the my brother boys, he was like, "You coming to Rome?" I was like, "Rome? What do you mean?" He's like, "I just thought you'd be coming to perform and be a part of it." And he must have hit someone up, and they rang me and were like, "Oh my God, we forgot you. Do you want to come to Rome?" And I was like, "Yeah, let's get it." So it was so late notice. I had to get someone to drive from Sydney to Temi to get me to sign these documents, get back. And before I knew it, I was over in Rome. And little did I know I was about to lead all these processions and be, a part of an historical moment.
Now, after you finished high school, you were enrolled in a bridging course at UNSW. The day before you began your course, you famously opened your front door to the head of the faculty, telling you not to step out of line or you would face expulsion. Can you tell me what led up to this moment?
Yeah, so I shouldn't have went to uni. Didn't have the scores. I didn't do much at school other than culture. That's what really kept me in school. Was my school was incredible, as in the fact that they let me practice and share culture and have a dance troupe and would go around to other schools, and they allowed me to major in the Yidaki from HSC. And then after school, everyone went to schoolies and I decided I wanted to be an academic. So I rang the programs and they looked at my report and just said, "Look, sorry, but I don't think your report meets the mark, you know." I'm like, "But can you let me in? You know, I want to do performing arts." And they said to me, "We don't do performing arts. There's, you can become a doctor, a lawyer, business, or social work." And I thought to myself, "Oh, social work seems the easiest. Yeah, I love social work. I think I want to do that." So I rang them every day and just harassed them till they went to a meeting, and they rang me one arvo and said, "Look, you're in. but you better not, you know, do the wrong thing by us. So I got down there and I remember it was Aunty Sue Green. She came knocking on our door, just gave it to us. She didn't muck around. You step out of line, you're gone. Don't let me down or make a fool out of me. You better. And I just remember in that moment, my stomach dropped. And it just really fell on me that, you know, this is a moment here to do something with your life. And I just switched on. And for that whole 4 weeks, I went as hard as I possibly could. And I went from literally failing my HSC to topping my faculty and got into uni and got a special award.